Welcome back, viewers and students, to a series on key texts in humanities and social science. I'm back today to discuss another relevant text by Max Weber and German sociologist. Let me remind you, when we began with this series, we started off with some of the important key texts in social sciences and humanities and try to understand the context of production, recirculation and production in the sense of trying to understand what context a writer is writing and try to understand the argument made by the thinkers. We've done a number of thinkers, and earlier in two of the lectures, one conducted by me, I talked about Weber's important text called Protestant Ethic and Spirit of Capitalism. In the second lecture delivered by Professor Maitri Chaudhary, his second one of his another text, which is Politics as Vocation, was discussed in detail. Today, I'm going to discuss a very important concept and important part of both social sciences and modern society, and the concept is bureaucracy. Bureaucracy was one of the essays written by Max Weber, in which he is trying to understand the process of changes that was introduced in the Western society due to the process of industrial revolution. And the entire, to repeat again and to try to understand the context in Max Weber was working, was a time of large scale changes due to French Revolution, Industrial Revolution, Reformation, the separation of church and the state. So this was a society which was overgoing large scale of changes in terms of all areas of changes was taking place in the politics, in economic, in social relation. And one of the major change in the society which was trying to bring about a revolution in the sense was the bringing in both of industry and coming in of the modern cities. This was actually done through the transition from a stage of religion, supernatural, to a more rational, more scientific society. And it was rationality which actually provoked Max Weber to try to understand the emergence of bureaucracy in the Western context. So before I go into the text, let us try to understand what is this term bureaucracy. If we go into the term bureaucracy, it is derived from the word bureau. It is a French meaning, which was the word from which it is derived is base. It is a French word, and it used to mean desk, table, cover. It is written only in the sense when we use bureau, it kind implies two kind of a meaning. One is a desk or a table or a writing surface. The other is an office or a workplace where official work is being done. So this was a context in which bureau was the content, and it was affixed with the term kresi. Kresia or kratos, which means power or rule. So if you combine bureau plus kresi, implies office with power or rule, and therefore it was used for the first time after the French Revolution by one of important thinkers called Vincent de Gournay. He used the term in 1745. After this French Revolution and the whole idea of liberty, fraternity, equality becoming an important part of Western society, the concept of bureaucracy became very relevant. So we see that it was not Weber who is using the term for the first time. What we need to keep in mind is that bureaucracy has been problematized by Max Weber to understand modern industrial society. So therefore, this is the reason why he is trying to give us the principal characteristics, features of bureaucracy. If you look at according to Vincent, the term bureau meant writing table and an office. It was suffixed with Greek word krisi, meaning for the rule. As I have already said, bureaucracy means an office with rule and an office with power. Bureaucracy thus basically implies office power or office rule, the rule of the officialdom. These are different ways in which we try to understand. But what is important to keep in mind is that Weber was trying to understand something very important, something very crucial, and that was how is society getting organized in a time of large scale change. And one of the principles by which he thought modern industrial society could be organized was bureaucracy. And therefore, his theory of Weberian bureaucracy is what generally is used is relevant not only in the social sciences but also in management and also in the other field of studies. It is an important theory which helps us to understand the principle of rationality, the principle of efficiency, and the whole idea of how capitalism in a way actually supported the organized rule-based system of working, and that was bureaucracy. When we look into Max Weber's contribution in social sciences, we see that he was one of the first and the most influential user of the term. Let us keep in mind that Weber was not a trained sociologist. He was by training, he had his education in law and later on went on to write a lot amount of books in related to society, economy and politics. But here when he's trying to understand society, he's trying to kind of develop an idea of law or rationality by which society is functioning. And in this context, it is important to keep in mind two or three important concepts that he has actually contributed in the field of social sciences. The first concept of Weber is ideal type. He used ideal type as a kind of a construct or a kind of a methodological tool in which he will actually try to understand different parts and process of the society. So he refers to the concept ideal type and bureaucracy in his essay published after World War, and in this essay he developed his idea of rationalization of modern capitalist society. When we look into the text, we see the first time the essay was published in 1921 in German as part of Economy and Society. In my earlier lecture, I have already said that some of his important texts other than Protestant Ethic and Society was Economy and Society, where he was trying to develop the notion of rationality. This text was later edited by his wife Marianne Weber. H.N.'s Goethe translated the text in 1930, and it was published with policing and commentary by C. Wright Mills, another sociologist, in 1946-47 in the book From Max Weber. If you look into actually a kind of a literature review, the alert of books which has been written on Max Weber and his theory, so it becomes very significant to try to see how his ideas were further developed by other sociologists. Weber's theory of bureaucracy was a response to the demand of industrial capitalist economy with required and efficient administration. If we look into this whole idea of capitalist economy, implies that there is a transition from a consumer-based society to a market economy in which the market is geared towards the sense of profit. Now, profit would be incurring more and more profit only if the production is done in an efficient manner, or in other words, it is done in a rational manner. And therefore, it required capitalist economy requires an organized setup through which he was trying to say that it is not only economy in itself which is going to change, but in its relations is going to be change in the political sphere as sense, because economy embeds power, economy embeds authority, and these are some of the other concepts which Weber has actually tried to comprehend in terms of understanding modern society. In the book Economy and Society, Weber described many ideal types of public administration and governance. And therefore, before we go into the text or we try to understand bureaucracy, it becomes very important that we try to understand the concept of ideal type. As I've already said in my earlier lecture, the methodology of Weber was Verstehen, or he was trying to provide an interpretative understanding of social action, and in this context he contributed or he gave us the concept of ideal type. Ideal type is basically a mental construct. It's like a model for the scrutiny and systematic characterization of a concrete situation. To state it simply, it just gives you states a number of characteristics or features which is like a model. But now reality could be very close to the model or it could differ from the model. So when we look into the bureaucracy, we see that bureaucracy is a kind of an ideal type, and therefore there is a lot of limitation when we try to understand something in the sense of ideal type, but at the same time it helps us to also look into the merits of the system. Ideal type is a methodological tool that helps us to look into reality, reality more objectively. Now, there are certain criteria which is given, and if we will try to understand any reality and reflect on the characteristics, it will help us to look into the reality in a more objective manner. It scrutinizes, classifies, systemizes, and defines social reality without subjective bias. The ideal types are nothing to do with value. So, that is what we'll discuss when we try to understand the concept and look into the kind of problem it has, that when certain values are attached to with system, it becomes problematic. Now, the second concept which is very important when we try to understand bureaucracy is power. By power, he means the ability of a person or institution to affect the will and behavior of other. That is, you can oppose your action on other because of certain kind of a legitimacy or certain time of authority which is granted to it. So, authority is legitimate use of power. When he is trying to understand authority, he is trying to actually understand the way in which certain setup, certain personnel are given certain kind of power to exercise certain rules, and that is what is the crux of bureaucracy. He emphasized the essence of social order to be found in norms and power to enforce them. If we keep in mind that when Weber tried to understand the system of social stratification, he told that it consists of class, status, and parties. Class is an economic power, status is social power, and parties is political power. So, all the threes are inherent power, and when it becomes a kind of a legitimate use, legitimate in the sense that it gets the consensus of majority, it becomes authority. Weber evolved a view of legal development as characterized by systematic change in the legal order and in the growth of authority. The law cannot be effective in the absence of power. So, that is why he is trying to understand, keep in mind that this is the separation of the church from the state, this emergence of state as a kind of a political institution. It is in this context that his learning towards law becomes very significant, and he says that law will become ineffective until unless it has comes in from a certain source, and that source could be a state or a machinery which will legitimize the use of power. That is in this context that he tries to understand authority. In his investigation of the legal history of society, he suggested three types of legitimate authority. When we look into the types of authority, the first authority is traditional authority. As the term itself says, the traditional authority gets its legitimacy from tradition. That is, it is accepted as correct, or it gets a consensus of majority because of something that has continued since the past. And one of the best example of traditional authority is patriarchy, or the rule of the father. So, in traditional or through ages, where men have been considered as superior to women, and therefore, the rule of the father becomes a kind of a authoritarian situation in the family. It does not change over time, does not facilitate social change, tends to be irrational, inconsistent, perpetuates status quo. Many arguments are in terms of because it is continuing from the past and without being questioned, at times becomes problematic. Weber states, and this is a quote from his book or text, the creation of new law opposite traditional law is deemed impossible in principle. So, whenever we question tradition, whenever we question kind of a setup which was, for instance, if we question feudalism, if we question patriarchy, we need to actually kind of get into a conflict with it in order to create a new order. The second authority is charismatic authority. Charismatic authority, as again the term suggests, is an authority which emerges from the quality of an individual. There is certain kind of a charisma, there is certain kind of magic in a person that people are ready to follow his or her order or take his authority as legitimate. So this is actually an extraordinary characteristic of an individual. We have n number of examples of charismatic authority, Mother Teresa, Mahatma Gandhi, all leaders, political leaders, social movement leaders have certain kind of quality in them which actually compels individual or a large mass of people to follow the orders that they give. A charismatic leader is the head of a new social movement and instilled with divine or supernatural power, such as a religious prophet. The third type of authority, which is significant in the understanding of bureaucracy, is legal rational authority. And again, the combination of the two phrases, legal and rational, implies that it is in a kind of an authority which is emerging from an institution or from a body or from a kind of an official rule, and therefore the authority exercised by individual has a certain kind of legality. So we can define it as kind of a formalistic belief in the content of the law or natural law. Obedience is not given to specific individual leader or not to certain assumptions or something which happened in the past, but it is given to the office. It is given to certain uniform principle for the authority which emerges from, say, the police force, the authority which emerges from the people in the government. This becomes legal rational authority. The purest form of the ideal type, so I have already discussed both the concept done by Weber in order to understand bureaucracy. The first is ideal type, which is a mental construct, and the second is authority. And Weber says that the most purest form of ideal type of legal rational authority is bureaucracy. So when we try to understand what is the link between bureaucracy and authority, we try to see that for Weber, bureaucracy was emerging from an office and therefore it was legal and it was based on the principle of rationality. When he tries to understand bureaucracy, he characterizes bureaucracy in terms of two major forms. One is patrimonial bureaucracy, which he feels would be found in system with traditional and charismatic authority. Patrimonial would be a society in which you have a kind of a patriarchal rule, or you have rule of the feudal lords, you have rule of the people who by defaults, for says the queen becomes a charismatic authority, and therefore the office within which it is considered as patrimonial bureaucracy. The legal rational bureaucracy, which is found in the legal type of authority. He identified a lot of rational legal features of rational legal authority. But before we go into bureaucracy, let us understand what is patrimonial bureaucracy. It is a form of political domination which authority rests on personal and bureaucratic power exercised by a royal household, where that power is formally arbitrary under the direct control of the ruler. So here it is not in terms of a sanction based on rule, or it is not coming legally, but again it is because of the past of certain kind of a group or a family being into power or being economically well off that they try to take a superior position compared to the mass, and they start kind of exercising coercive power on them, and therefore it takes the shape of a bureaucratic organization. Examples of bureaucratic monarchies and governments could be in terms of, as I already said, in terms of large number of societies in which you have traditional rules and charismatic rules. When extreme development of ruler's discretion has occurred, the patrimonial authority fades into what Weber calls sultanism. That is, it almost kind of becomes a monopolic exercise of power by an individual or a single group, and therefore it becomes in terms of the rule of that individual person or the family. And that is again here when the term used, sultanism. Example of patrimonial bureaucracies are traditional African Oriental societies. These systems are relatively unstable because they encourage palace revolts as the only means of voicing dissent. As I already said earlier, in traditional authority, the whole idea of questioning or the past or questioning the authority of individual always end up in kind of a revolt or kind of a violence between those who have authority and on those who are denied of it. The second form of bureaucracy is, and which is the central argument or around which Weber discusses the entire concept of bureaucracy, is the legal rational bureaucracy. Weber designed his ideal type of bureaucracy keeping in mind the legal rationality. I already explained it earlier. So let us try to understand why is it called rational. It is called rational because its means are expressively designed to achieve certain specific end. And rationality here, why do we need a system called bureaucracy and bureaucratic organization? It is needed in order to have efficiency. And why is efficiency required? Efficiency is required in order to garner the maximum kind of production or garner the maximum amount of profit in order to ensure that capitalism is able to sustain itself. It is legal because authority is exercised by a means of systems of rules and procedure. His model of bureaucracy is also known as Weberian model of bureaucracy, and this model is relevant in all fields of social sciences and in all kinds of management studies, in whether we go into public sector or private sector, into a capitalist society or welfare society, Weberian model of bureaucracy is very relevant. Now we try to understand, or rather this now we try to concentrate on Weber's understanding of bureaucracy. If we now read the entire essay, we find that Weber never defined the concept. He only was only trying to look into the administrative setup, or he was trying to look into a society which was organized around certain principles, around certain features which could help us to understand the whole way in which rationality was helping individual to achieve the goals in society. And therefore, he described it as administrative body of appointed officials. According to Weber, bureaucracy a goal-oriented organization designed according to rational principle in order to efficiently attain their goals. Now, this whole idea of bureaucracy is not something which was there in the earlier period, and therefore there are certain conditions which has actually been supportive for the growth of bureaucratic organization. And repeatedly I have said that rationality or rationalism is the first principle. Secondly is the capitalist economy, because earlier in a socialist economy or in a society or based on kind of home economy or subsistence economy, bureaucracy would have no place because it was a family-based economy. There would be no requirement of rule, there would be no requirement of authority. Therefore, capitalist, where there is a kind of a owner of modes of production and those who are denied the ownership, has to be there in order to create an hierarchy and an authority. Growth of a democratic institution. Democratic institution is required in order to legitimize the use of power within, if it is kind of an organization which too much of power is given to an individual or to a group, there could be kind of a conflict and violence, and therefore the need of a democratic structure in order for the sustenance of bureaucracy. The fourth conditions for the emergence of bureaucracy is the emergence of complex administrative process. So, in order to get any work, we are all part of a democratic bureaucratic setup. We know there are n number of process, n number of rules and regulations which has to be put into, we have to go through it in order to get the work done, and this is required because it is a rule based system. Fifth is development of modern means of communication, and lastly is the growth of population. Now, when we look into the concept of bureaucracy, Weber has given certain principles or features of which is considered as Weberian model of bureaucracy. The first principle of Weberian model is impersonal order. This implies that in an office, individuals are there as part of an organization, and there is no personal attachment. It is the duty that the individual is set, and the individual has to do his or her duty irrespective of the personal attachment or kind of a personal relation. And that becomes very important, that bureaucracy implies impersonality. Regulations and clear requirement create distance and impersonal relations between employer. It could be that the two person in an office are related through kind of a kinship, could be through blood or marriage, but at the office, personal relations are not to be expressed, are not to be part of the office work. Interpersonal relations are solely characterized by a system of public law and rules and requirements. Officials' views are free from any personal involvement, emotions and feelings. So many a time there's a lot of discussions or lot of movies and social media there, that certain people in the officials could be a judge who has to give a death sentence to his own relative, but at that time it becomes impersonal. These are all characteristics of modern society, contemporary society. Decisions are solely made on the basis of rational factor rather than personal factors. So, no, there is no hereditary, there is no kind of a blood relations or marital relations which will actually decide the judgment or will decide the decision of the office bearers. The second principle is division of labor. Labor is divided so that the authority and responsibility are clearly defined. Now, it is an organized setup where people with different skills, with different roles are assigned different kind of a work. And therefore, each kind of work is divided according to skills, capability and background. So, there has to be a rational relation why an individual is doing a certain kind of a work. And those with higher skills, with higher educational, higher capability are then offered more remuneration, and that will create an hierarchy in the society. Division of labor is again an important concept, and which we have already dealt when we talked about Durkheim, which sees the emergence of modern society. There is a kind of an organic division of labor where each individual is going to do certain kind of work dependent on his own acquired skills and capacity. Now, why is division of labor required, especially in a bureaucratic setup? Because it will improve the kind of an efficiency which is required. The third principle of Bavarian bureaucracy is formal selection. Now, earlier selections were done in a traditional economy or a home-based economy. Many of the time, it is through personal mouth, word of mouth, and knowing each other personally, that people were given employment or people were sharing work together in a family setup. With the emergence of bureaucracy, we see that there is a kind of a formal selection system, and this selection is based on kind of a technical skills, competencies which have been acquired through tradition and experience. So, the entire system of education, the entire system of skills, training are all geared up in order to allow bureaucracy to function in the normal sense. So, the fourth principle is framework of rules. Since bureaucracy implies rules, we cannot do away without rules. Any office, any organization has to have rules, and the rules are applicable to every members of the organization, irrespective of the position or irrespective of the compensation that he or she is withdrawing. Everybody follows the same procedures to increase efficiency and predictability so that organization will produce similar results in similar circumstances. Uniformity of rule for everyone is also a result to avoid a less kind of a conflict or kind of a disorder in the functioning of everyday functioning of office. The fifth is hierarchy of authority. Now, this becomes very significant when we look into authority because bureaucratic system implies hierarchy. It is those who are at the top, who are at the level, are those who have better educations, those who have better skills, are able to create a kind of a vertical hierarchy in which those at the higher positions are even allowed to exert more power on the earth and are able to supervise and get larger compensation. A bureaucracy is a setup with clear chain of command so that everyone has a boss. At the top of the organization is a chief who oversees the entire bureaucracy, and power flows downwards. If we look into bureaucratic setup in terms of economy and politics, we see power is flowing downward. That is, the highest authority, those in the highest position, will have higher power, and it goes down in the sense of economic gain, because those at the top have highest power as well as high economic returns. The sixth principle of the Weberian model of bureaucracy is separation of personal and public ends. So, the professional and the personal does not meet together. So, official space is not a space for private get together or for family functions, but it is only a place for strict business conduct and for the earning of large amount of income. Offices are not appropriated by the incumbent, inherited or sold. It is fixed. It is through formal system of recruitment. So, one cannot employ or just give a job to anybody. And in that context, we need to separate the personal and the public. The seventh principle of Weberian bureaucracy is written document. And obviously, because it is based on rationality and it is based on kind of legal setup, everything has to be written, and everything, all rules, all code of conduct and the roles and responsibility are maintained in written documents. Now, we try to understand that this was how Weber tried to explain the characteristics of modern society, a society which shifted from say agricultural get or from a home based economy or a community based society to a modern industrial society, where each one was being given a certain kind of education, were acquiring certain kind of skills, and accordingly were getting certain the same kind of a job. But what was problem with bureaucracy was, and Weber has acknowledged this in his text, is that it has large amount of demerits. With all its merits in terms of organized efficiency and rationality, what happens is that large amount of people who starts controlling these offices starts turning into a kind of an oligarchy. So, he saw bureaucracy as a system of control based on rational rule, with the goal of achieving maximum efficiency, and in a kind of a way it leads to a system where only few are those who have acquired the relevant education, relevant skills, and therefore they are the ones who have all kind of power with them, economic power, social power and political power, and it is a small group in contrast to a larger masses who are denied this. Bureaucratic administration means fundamentally the exercise of control on the basis of knowledge. This is the feature of it which makes it specifically rational. And this is something which the system of control, which inherently contradicts bureaucratic organization, and it gives ways to oligarchy. The negative side was misuse of power and rules by those in power. Bureaucracy does not function as an ideal type, and this is when we look into Weber's concept of bureaucracy and we see that more or less like kind of a Durkheimian functionalist, he is looking into the positive side of it and he is negating the conflict side, but towards the end he is making us cautious of the fact that it has an inherent contradiction, and if it is not utilized, and then it becomes a kind of system in which it is not similar to what was suggested in the ideal type. It has the potential to develop into an oligarchic system of political domination. This term of oligarchy was given by Robert Meissel, who saw that it was a sentiment of the modern society in which too much of control, too much of rationality was resulting in a kind of an iron law of oligarchy. Iron law of oligarchy implies political that is rule by an elite. An elite are a few individual or those who are on the top of the hierarchy or the stratification ladder. They are the ones who have political power, economic power and social power. Rather, all the three works together, and they are few in number. So, they are able to coerce their action on the larger part. And he says that the negative outcome of bureaucracy is the emergence of oligarchy within a democratic organization. Now, when we look into a lot of literature from the economic aspect from our own country, and we look into a lot of data where we see a certain percentage, a very small percentage of the Indians are able to earn a larger portion of what 70% of the population is all not earning. This implies that those who have been able to set themselves in either in the bureaucracy or at the higher level of political system are able to create a system in which they are become politically and economically powerful, and therefore it becomes a kind of an oligarchy. Mitchell argues that oligarchy resulted from the imperatives of modern organization, competent leadership, centralized authority, and the division of tasks within a professional bureaucracy. And this is the entire link between one and the other, because we have bureaucracy in place. We required officials to be placed in the ladder. Those who have highest amount of education on the upper ladder, those who have less on the lower hierarchy. Now, how do we produce those few topmost personnel is through education. And now, how do we achieve that education? It is again through a certain kind of expenditure. And when we expend certain kind of amount onto earning a certain kind of education, we are able to acquire certain skill and we take the topmost position. In this, it becomes a vicious circle. So, those who have power continue to reap the power again and again, and there becomes a big divide between those who have economic political power and those who are denied from it. And this is the result of a bureaucratic setup. And from this itself, when we see that bureaucracy leads to a kind of an oligarchy or the iron law of oligarchy, we see that Weber's bureaucracy was not without a certain kind of a shortcoming or certain kind of limitations. There are large number of authors who have tried to look into the different kinds of limitation in here. The first criticism was that it is a machine theory, and this was given by an important scholar called Goldner. He tested his ideal type of bureaucracy over many decades and found internal contradiction that reflected tensions between claims of expertise and obedience based on discipline, and called Weber's theory as a machine theory. This is called a machine theory because it is said in a very commonsensical, power corrupts power, in the sense that bureaucratic systems or bureaucracy is not without limitation. It does not work in the most efficient manner. So, there is lot of kind of concentration of power within hands of individuals, and therefore, they were not going to work efficiently for the system, but they are going to work in order to improve on their own position in the ladder, and therefore, it is a kind of a theory which does not explain or does not cater to what has been described in Weber's theory of bureaucracy. The second criticism is that it is not suitable for developing countries, and this is very important because remember, Weber was looking into the social economic context of the Western society, and he was looking into how it was bureaucracy as a form of organization was emerging in the Western society in the early 20th century. So, it does it need that it fits into every kind of economic and political system? No, it does not. So, Pristhas also pointed that Weberian model is a product of an alien culture which is fairly inadequate for imposition in developing countries. And if we try to understand this from our own country, which is a developing country, we see that bureaucracy is full of problem. Red tapism is something which is very familiar, that it is so much of corruption, there is so much of inefficiency within bureaucratic setup that it does not able to cater to the demands of a large number of individuals who are dependent on the welfare state. So, we need to keep in mind that bureaucracy would be suitable where there are a kind of a less difference between the haves and have-nots, or those who are economically well and economically poor. So there the system could more or less functions, but in a place where there is no uniformity and where the state or the welfare state plays an important role or should play an important role in terms of distribution of resources to those who are on the margins and those who are beyond poverty line, bureaucracy then becomes problematic, because it was again it kinds of leads into a kind of a different debate when we look into the corruption within bureaucracy, the red tapism within bureaucratic organization, the inefficiency within bureaucratic organization, and the kind of outcomes that it had in terms of failures of programs for welfare of the society. The third criticism obviously comes in from Karl Marx, and he says that bureaucracy is only an arm of state. Now, when we look into Karl Marx's theory, and if we are familiar, we know Karl Marx was providing us a theory, economic understanding of class, in terms of those who have the means of ownership, who are kind of a capitalist class, and they are utilizing their positions and their status in order to exploit the working class or the have-nots. Now, Karl Marx looks into bureaucracy only as a weapon or a tool in the hands of the state, that by which the state would exploit the working class, and therefore it could be very close to somewhere we look into the elitist society, or the power and politics being concentrated within few, and it is being used in terms to get rid of the kind of those who are on the margins and are not able to sustain the system. So, in that context, Karl Marx would say that bureaucracy is exploitative, bureaucracy is not good for the society. The next criticism comes from another stalwart of social sciences, and that's Talcott Parson. He says that bureaucracy leads into conflicts among officials, and therefore it becomes very important to try to understand bureaucratic system is again based on hierarchy and authority, and there is a kind of competition among all officials to rise up. So, rather than actually contributing to the maintenance of the system or to the society itself, there is a kind of a self-motivation to improve on its own system in order to be able to attain the highest position. So, Talcott Parson says that there will always be conflict with subordination and hierarchy, as the person issuing order might not have the professional skill for the job of juniors. And if we look around ourselves, we know that there is so much of competition and there is so much of expenses around education and acquiring of state in just in order to be a part of the bureaucratic system. And if we go back and we see our own society, we know that Indian administrative system, where the bureaucrats are, is actually a hobby for a large number of Indian youth. A majority of them are aspirant to become and IS officer. Why? Because of the power and authority that is attached to the officials. So, it is a kind of a conflicting situation as well. However, in spite of the limitations or the drawbacks, we know Weber's theory of bureaucracy was very relevant, and it is relevant even today when we try to understand the economy and polity all around us. So, let us look into the relevance of Weber's theory, and when we try to understand the relevance, we see that we have not been able to try to develop an alternative. Even though Karl Marx was critical, he has not been able to suggest an alternative to bureaucracy, and that is what in his text Weber very categorically mentions, that we have not been able to develop an alternative because we have got used to bureaucracy. Rather, it seems to appear to be the most efficient way of working, and therefore we adhere to the rules and principles of bureaucracy. The second relevance is that it is found everywhere, whether you look into a capitalist society or a welfare society, or you look into a socialist society, the bureaucratic organization is found. So nowadays, even when we look into the functioning of non-governmental organization or not profit based organization, even they have some kind of a bureaucratic structure where there is a kind of an office, there is a hierarchy, though they are working with community, though they are working for social causes, but the bureaucratic structure is present there. So whether it be a public office or a private office or a non-corporate organization or a social organization, structures of bureaucracy are found everywhere. The third relevance is that it is religiously followed by government. And why is it religiously followed by government? Because it helps you to actually organize the system. It helps you because it has this principle of formal selection, it has principle of authority and hierarchy, it is a system based on rules, it's a system based on written documents. The government or the political bodies find it convenient to rely on a bureaucratic structure in order to be able to function efficiently and effectively. The next relevance of Weber's theory of bureaucracy is that it is a system which allows you to work with greater efficiency. In spite of the limitations or kind of criticism, it is a system which has a kind of allocation of resources, division of labor, and therefore it leads to kind of working more efficiently. Welfare state cannot boycott bureaucracy. And why this I have already explained earlier, that it is a system where there is a kind of lot of needs like education, health, and many other demands which has to be supported by the state, though the state may be moving towards a capitalist state, but by and large the nature of a welfare state implies that it is able to produce resources to those who are incapable of acquiring it themselves. So therefore, if we do not have a system where you have a bureaucracy who is authorized the task of functioning efficiently and ensuring that resources are allocated to individuals across the caste, class, state and religious, then we need a bureaucracy to function effectively. Weber's primarily concerned, if we look into the text of bureaucracy, we see that he has been able to look into the characteristic of Western society in which he developed it from capitalism. Historical and comparative studies of world major civilizations, study of the original capitalist development and rationalism. Now I come to a concluding part and discuss why Weber matters today. Weber matters today because everywhere around us we see the principle of rationality, whether from right from nursery training to college education. Rationality is required in order to function efficiently in our society. Place of work, promotions, everything is based on skills and capability. Until retirement, we are calculating our retirement funds and do investment. It's all based on the principle of rationality. We are counting calories at dinner, how much of calories we take, how much of weight we gain. Everything is based on the principle of rationality. Everything we are doing on the basis of how much of gain or loss we are doing in everyday life. Our highways, parks, suburbs all look same. They are based on security and predictability, to be sure, but at the cost of spontaneity and creativity. So we see a society which is moving towards rationality, which is moving towards scientific calculation. Everything is based on zero sum gain or loss principle, and that is leading to a kind of end of creativity, end of reflexibility. And this is why it is very important to go back to Weber's bureaucracy and try to look into it and read it in order to understand the context or the society in which we are all becoming a kind of part of the rat race or part of the consumer market, and every action of our has a rational logical explanation behind it. I hope I've been able to explain the concept of bureaucracy as discussed by Weber and also explain its relevance in today's society. With this, I come to an end of today's lecture. Thank you.